All right, so I've just built this. It's actually identical to one of the other circuits I've featured on my channel, but it was a few years ago. The only difference is I slightly modified it, not much, and then I put it in a box. Now, one of you is probably gonna comment, "What's in the box? Open the box." You know, I'll get there. Just chill, Eric. So it's just a high voltage pulse DC power supply, basically. Main power that turns it on, flipping it upwards, and then this button is what makes it go. Frequency and voltage output are adjustable by turning that screw. Frequency and voltage output are inversely related because this is a spark gap timer. Let's see what else. Oh yeah, it's rechargeable, USB rechargeable, because I do everything like that. I just plug this in and then it charges it. I don't know the runtime on it, but I'm assuming it's a really long time because it barely uses any power. It's the wattage. It's around, the original circuit was 0.08 watts that I used. So it's just a bug zapper circuit. I have the schematic drawn out in one of my other videos. I don't feel like drawing it out again right now. It's just a oscillator, it's just a transistor capacitor transformer feedback transformer oscillator going into a voltage multiplier. It has four diodes. They are 1N4007 diodes with four ceramic capacitors. I think they're like 0.22 microfarads. I don't know, 2.2 microfarads, I think. And then those feed into a capacitor bank. Originally, it was a 1.6 kV cap. Well, I put three 22, no, 3.22 microfarad caps at 2,000 volts each in parallel. There's three of them. That goes through the spark gap timer. And that's in series with a flyback transformer. So this is just the ground of the flyback, and this would be the thick red wire coming out of the top of the flyback. Let's see. It's the one that looks like this if you've ever taken apart a TV or, you know, a CRT, cathode ray tube type TV. It's one of these. That's what I'm using here. I didn't wind anything around the ferrite core. That takes much more current. This is a very, very low current device. Very low. So it's relatively safe. But it's not the best circuit. It's not perfect. There's a few problems with it. And one of them is if you don't give it a small enough gap to arc, it will bite you. It will backfeed through the circuit, and I've tried troubleshooting it. I don't have it figured out. I've tried putting different high voltage capacitors on there, filtering it or taking it to ground. I've used diodes, high voltage diodes, taking it to ground. Resistors, I've used resistors, taking the any backfeeding from the switch to ground. But this thing, I don't even know how it's backfeeding at this point. I really don't know. You can do some cool stuff with it as long as you give it an arc space. High voltage, I don't like playing with it much because it's annoying. It's an animal that doesn't want to be tamed. It does whatever it wants to do. There we go. Let's plug it in for charge. Okay, so this is a neon bulb. I'll hold the other side of it. All right, lights are off. This is a neon bulb. I will hold one side of it, and the other side will be open. Not open. I'll just touch it to the side of the switch. Can see it. flickers. It turns on. Even touching the screws on here, yeah, I just lit up more. Yeah, it's discharging high voltage off of this switch, which is only seeing about 4 volts at any time. 0 to 4 volts, that's it. But it's still... See, it's just near it. But it's very prominent on any metal. Not good. So if you build one of these, insulate the crap out of it. Insulate over the circuit, like the buttons and everything else. I'll change this to the spark frequency. It'll disappear. And you can change this on the fly too. Just don't touch the spark gap with, like, and any of the wires. You will ground part of it and get a pretty good jolt. As I speed it up, I need to make the gap smaller. There we go. I'll speed it up a little bit more to make the gap smaller. Ooh, ozone. Definitely smell it. Let's speed up a little bit more. The faster it goes, the smaller the gap you gotta use. And you can use this to light up gas discharge tubes. Like this light. If I change the frequency, you'll see it pulse. You'll see it flicker. And I turn it, I'll speed it up. Up until the spark gap shorts out, but there we go. Big snappy arcs. Alright, I'll turn on the lights and I'll show you what's inside this thing. And I'm going to change the radiator. Alright, what's inside this thing? Make sure it's turned off. Okay. It's not pretty inside, but here it is. I'm surprised it even fit. This is plastic folded over and electrical taped around to insulate the shit out of the positive. Where's that cable? Out of this. Because this is only rated for like 30 kV. Well, I'm putting more than that through it. It's jumping through. Especially where I made the connection from this into the thinner wire. I wanted solid core, even more rigid. So the basic circuit. I mean, there it is. There's the voltage multiplier. You see the little charging board right there. Red LED means charging. The battery is right here. It's a 18650 lithium ion cell. I wrapped it up with a lot of tape just to insulate it too, because high voltage, it likes to jump and go wherever it wants to go. There's a theory that electricity takes the path of least resistance. Well, it's kind of true. The path of least resistance takes the most current. There's also paths of more resistance that it still takes. Like a lightning bolt, you see one bolt, but there's also a bunch of other branches to it. So it still wanted to jump to anything in here, even if it wasn't the biggest arc taking the most current, because this one is. But I noticed it was still jumping to the battery. It was jumping all over the place. So I basically just insulated the crap out of the high voltage stuff. I did lots of heat shrink around it, and then plastic, electrical tape, give it an air gap. And that seemed to work for the most part. There's the spark gap timer, just a section of Schedule 80 PVC with two screws. You know, how simple is that? Been doing it for years and it works great. There's the bug zapper circuit. It's, see the transformer right there. GoPros don't do up close stuff, but just take my word for it. There's 7 capacitors in here, 4 diodes, plus that one I added on the flyback. So I'm just feeding it in here. Really, really primitive, really simple, really ugly looking, but it works. So practical applications, not really any. Or much at all, except for lighting these up, making sparks and arcs. If you like doing that, it'll work. It'll charge high voltage capacitors, not very quickly, but it can. You know, very low capacity ones, it'll charge them. Like foil plastic, like overhead projector sheets in foil layered up. It'll charge those. I've done that with this already. It'll ignite propane, butane, flammable gases. It'll ignite those, so safety warning. It's too low of current to ignite paper or anything like that, so if you're building this to try that, you need a lot more energy, or you need a high frequency AC arc. A flyback will do that great. You'll need an arc a little more like this. I'll kill the light. You need an arc like this if you're gonna use it to, you know, burn things with. This is a plasma arc. This is also a feature in some of my videos. It's also using a flyback, but it's also running at 124 watts, not 0.08. And it's a AC circuit, not pulse DC. But very different. How long is this video? Holy shit, 10 minutes. Alright, I'm gonna wrap it up there. We'll put this thing back together. And yeah. Thanks for watching.